Good morning. I'd like to welcome everyone here this morning. It's good to gather to worship together and welcome everyone who's joining us online at a later moment. As everyone's probably aware of now, there is no soup in a bun today. We're going to have a potluck on the 11th instead. Nobody signed up to make soup or anything, so we decided we'd just make a potluck on the 11th. More details about that to be announced. Are there other announcements? I'm sure there are.
Good morning. Okay, the Donelda announcements for today. First of all, I have some sad news for some of you in the congregation who will remember Betty and Bruce Welsh. Bruce died this week. He had a stroke in December and has been bedridden since. And so Marianne left me a message and asked me to announce in church today. Betty is in reasonable health, but it looks like her daughter Lori is going to be doing some more care with her. And greets, if you haven't signed up already, please do. The sign-up sheet is on the pillar by the elevator door, and the tickets are $10. I have 20 seats reserved already. But if you're thinking of coming, and I haven't checked the list today, if there's more than 20, if you think you're going to come, please sign up so that I can reserve some more tickets. And she said no soup and bun, so that's it. Thank you.
No other announcements?
Next Sunday afternoon at 3:30, if you would like, you could. I'm inviting you to come to my class piano recital. I have students from 7 to 17, quite literally, so if you'd like to come and enjoy that, that would be lovely. And on June the 9th, which I know is the same night as the beginning of homecoming, but if you're not involved in that, June the 9th is a recital that my senior students are doing. And it's called Recital and Celebration 6th Anniversary. So some of you may not know, 6 years ago we fundraised to buy the piano in our church. And at that time, Suzanne Sebeck and Janet Lynn were senior students of mine. Janet Yang, I should say, were senior students of mine. And you might just remember that the last Arts in 817 concert, Suzanne played on that concert. So 6 years later, she kind of graduated. So on June the 9th, there will be my four senior students, Ava Gertz, Brianna Hollingsworth, Gabriel and Elizabeth Miller. There'll be flute music, piano duet, piano quartets, and a concerto. So it'll be a lovely evening, and the parents are providing a reception after. So if you'd like to join us on June the 9th at 7:30, that would be lovely.
Good evening, as many of you will know, all the red I see out there. It's Pentecost Sunday today. It's the day we celebrate the Holy Spirit, the gift of the Holy Spirit making manifest to the church. Ruth reminded me that on Pentecost I usually wear my
red socks.
And they're actually cooler than the shoes I was wearing, so this is great. It's every time I don't wear shoes in the pulpit. So Pentecost Sunday. So today we light the candle, and it's just a tiny little flame reminding us of the presence of Christ always with us, the Holy Spirit always with us, and the gift of the two testaments.
Thank you.
Let your heart overflow with the living water that renews the face of the earth.
Hallelujah. Thanks be to God.
And our opening hymn is Voices United 218, We Praise You, O God.
Thank you.
The button is pushed. I can see him. Well, today, we come to church because we come to church to learn about Jesus, right? Yes. So today, the story is a story of Pentecost. And in Pentecost, we use the color red. Can you see red things around the church today? What's red? And Pentecost is the time when Jesus was going to go away and he sent the Holy Spirit down onto the church. And what do you think that might feel like, having the Holy Spirit come down on the church? Well, the people felt very glad and very happy. And some of them started dancing. And there was a whole big group of people and they spoke in their own language. Have you heard people speak other languages? No? Well, just think if we had everyone here and there were 5 or 6 different languages being spoken at the same time. What do you think that would sound like? Yeah, it might sound joyous. Yes, it's hard to know because we haven't heard that, have we? No. So that's what we're celebrating today, the Holy Spirit coming down. So, and the Holy Spirit makes us comfortable and happy. So let's have a little prayer and then we can go on with service. Can we pray? Okay. Dear Lord, thank you for sending your Holy Spirit to comfort us and be with us. Bless us now as we learn more about Jesus. To help give us the energy of the Holy Spirit descending on the church that day. So I'll invite people forward and they can, I'll pass it over to you to do our special music. It's out of More Voices. You'll have that in your pews. The More Voices, number 23. Come, O Holy Spirit.
And you're allowed to dance. And join in. And clap.
Oh,
The scripture this morning is from Revelations 1, verses 9 to 20. I, John, your brother, who share with you in Jesus the persecution and the kingdom and the patient endurance, was on the island called Patmos because of the word of God and the testimony of Jesus. I was in the Spirit on the Lord's day, and I heard behind me a loud voice, like a trumpet, saying, write in a book what you see and send it to the seven churches, to Ephesus, Smyrna, to Pergamum, to Thyatira, to Sardis, to Philadelphia, and to Laodicea. Then I turned to see whose voice it was that spoke to me, and on turning I saw seven golden lampstands, and in the midst of the lampstands I saw one like the Son of Man, clothed with a long robe and with a golden sash across his chest. His head and his hair were white, as white wool, white as snow. His eyes were like a flame of fire. His feet were like burnished bronze, refined as in a furnace. And his voice was like the sound of many waters. In his right hand, he held seven stars. And from his mouth came a sharp two-edged sword. And his face was like the sun, shining with full force. When I saw him, I fell at his feet as though dead. But he placed his right hand on me, saying, do not be afraid. I am the first and the last and the living one. I was dead, and I see. I am alive forever and ever, and I have the keys of death and of Hades. Now write what you have seen, what is to take place after this. As for the mystery of the seven stars that you saw in my right hand, and the seven golden lampstands, the seven stars are the angels of the seven churches, and the seven lampstands are the seven churches. This is the word of our Savior and Lord.
Thanks be to God.
And let us pray. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of all our hearts be acceptable in your sight, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. Revelation, the unveiling or disclosure of Jesus Christ. Revelation, the lifting of a cover or the pulling back of a curtain. The lifting of a cover has a purpose. The first is to set the present moment in the light of the future. He is coming. The second is to set the present moment in light of the unseen realities of the present. Things are not as they seem. There is more to reality than meets the unaided senses. There is more to the reality of the present moment than we can know with our eyes and our ears. If we are aware of the unseen in the present moment and know the present moment in light of the future, then we can see, hear, feel, and react to our present circumstances differently. John begins with a prologue and concludes with an epilogue. The two texts put the larger middle section, the middle drama, into a theological perspective. Revelation itself is made up in five sections. 4:1, I looked, and look, the door was opened in heaven. 11:19, and the temple of God, which is in heaven, was opened. 15:5, I looked, and the temple of the tabernacle of testimony in heaven was opened. And 19:11, I saw heaven opened. The first section, today's reading, does not begin with the word open, but with the word heard. I heard behind me a loud voice. The imagery of the revelation comes alive in the imagination through hearing it. In the experience that John conveys, Jesus lifts the cover pulls back the curtain and lets John in on the most important unseen reality of the present. And it changed the way John coped with what was going on in the world and in his personal life. In the year 96, current era, John, the beloved disciple, now in his mid-80s, is in exile on the prison island of Patmos, out in the Aegean Sea, which is part of the reason for the strange cryptic language of the Book of Revelation. Any letter John would write from Patmos to the churches on the mainland would be read by prison censors. So he writes in a style that allows him to convey a message the Roman authorities will not understand, and probably dismiss as the senseless ramblings of an old man under stress. Why did John end up on Patmos? The Roman government maintained rock quarries on Patmos, to which criminals and troublemakers were sent to spend the rest of their lives. There was no parole. 4 years earlier, in 92, life became extremely difficult for the disciples of Jesus living in the Roman Empire. Life had been hard enough up to that time. In 67, Emperor Nero was feeding Christians to the lions. The apostles Peter and Paul were crucified during that period. But in 92, things got even worse. The emperor at that time was Domitian, who was a profoundly insecure man who lived in morbid fear of being overthrown. To compensate for his insecurity, he had a temple built, and all peoples, the Roman citizens and subjects, were to worship him as Lord and God. They were to take a pinch of incense, throw it on the altar, and pay homage to Caesar as God, saying the words, "Caesar is Lord." For most Roman citizens, this posed no problem at all. Most were polytheists, so what is one more god? They could take part in such ceremonies without troubling their conscience. But not for John. John could respect Caesar. He could pay taxes to Caesar, but he would not worship him. For John, there was only one Lord, one person who could demand total allegiance, and that person is Jesus Christ. So John graciously refused to take the pinch of incense and cast it on the altar, saying Jesus is Lord. From the state's perspective, John is a troublemaker, a threat to Roman unity. He has to be punished. The authorities could have killed John on the spot. We know that in the year 92, Domitian had something like 40,000 Christians killed. Timothy was beaten to death during that period. But John was not killed. He was too prominent a figure. Killing John would have made him a martyr, and the Romans would not risk renewing the spirit of the minority movement by making John a martyr. So instead, they ship him off to Patmos. While on Patmos, Domitian's reign of terror intensified for the churches John knew and loved. Churches in cities like Ephesus, Smyrna, Pergamum, Thyatira, Sardis, Philadelphia, and Laodicea. As John looks across the Aegean Sea, he can, in his mind's eye, see many Christians who were confused, discouraged, and afraid. There was pressure to conform to the emperor's edict. Many Christians were harassed by soldiers, many losing their businesses and homes, many being murdered. On top of that, heresy and immorality were gaining footholds in a number of the congregations. John says that he was in the Spirit on the Lord's day. He had been worshiping in the power of the Holy Spirit on Sunday morning. He had, no doubt, been praying about all that was going on. He had, no doubt, been crying out to the Lord. And how does the Lord respond? By telling John to have the elders form a task force on political terror? By giving John a set of new programs to be implemented in the various congregations on the mainland? No. by giving John a strategy by which Christians could slowly displace pagans in public office? No. By giving John more cash for the church's budget? No. How does Jesus respond? He lifts the cover. He pulls back the curtain. Jesus responds with a revelation, with an unveiling of the unseen reality of the present. Jesus responds by giving John a powerful vision of who he is. I am sure as John sat on the rock piles, he was able to bring to mind all kinds of mental pictures of Jesus. So can we. There is the picture of Jesus in Galilee, turning 120 gallons of water into vintage wine. There is a picture of Jesus in Jerusalem, driving the money changers out of the temple. There is a picture of Jesus feeding the 5,000 with 5 loaves and 2 fish. There is the picture of Jesus calming the raging storm by simply speaking a few words. Who is it that even the wind and the waves obey? There is the picture of Jesus raising Lazarus from the dead. There is the picture of Jesus himself outside the empty tomb. And every picture would help John. But this is a new situation, and John needed more. And so do we. He needed to see Jesus Christ as he is now. I was in the Spirit on the Lord's day, says John, and I heard behind me a voice like the sound of a trumpet. Notice how John describes the experience. I heard the voice behind me. This experience is not simply in his head. It was not some inner mystical experience. It was something external to himself, something outside himself, a voice behind me. And I turned to see the voice. Whether the soldiers guarding John and John's fellow prisoners heard the voice, we are not told. But they would have seen John turn his body to face something outside himself. I turned to see the voice. And when he did, he saw a person. The same person who lived in Palestine with him some 60 years before. The same person on whose breast he leaned during the Last Supper. But now, different. I turned and saw one like the Son of Man. John is choosing his words carefully. Son of Man is a Hebraic way of saying human being. But John uses the term in a way that says more. John uses a technical term, one that comes out of the Hebrew Bible. John is referring to that towering figure of the great vision God gave the prophet Daniel hundreds of years before. We encounter this great vision in Daniel 7. I saw in the night visions, and behold, with the clouds of heaven, there came one like the Son of Man. And he came up to the Ancient of Days and was presented before him. And to him was given dominion, glory, and a kingdom, that all peoples, nations, and languages should serve him. His dominion is everlasting dominion, which shall not pass away. And his kingdom is one which shall not be destroyed. The phrase, one like a Son of Man, refers to the central figure in history, to the one to whom all kingdoms of this world are given. One like the Son of Man refers to a pre-existent, heavenly being who comes to establish a kingdom that cannot be destroyed. I turned to see the voice, and I saw 7 golden lampstands, and in the midst of the lampstands, one like the Son of Man. Later in the encounter, John learns that the 7 lampstands represent the 7 churches that are on John's heart. In the midst, not above looking down, not outside looking in, right there in the middle of the churches is the glorified Son of Man, which is why in each of the messages that Jesus then dictates to the seven churches. Jesus can say, I know your fears. I know your pain. I know your emptiness. The risen and living Jesus lives and moves among his churches. He is moving among us right now. John tries to describe the towering figure in our midst. He reaches for all kinds of imagery to convey the full reality of the one who transcends all images. The first thing that catches John's attention is the way that Jesus is dressed. I saw one like the Son of Man, clothed in a robe reaching to his feet and a golden sash across his chest. What statement is Jesus making in clothing himself that way? The robe is a priest's robe, the robe of a high priest, like the one Aaron wore. The glorified Son of Man is the great high priest. And a golden sash across his chest. When a sash is worn around the waist, one is preparing for work. When it is worn across the chest, the person was resting in the accomplishment of the task. John is being reminded that the work of Jesus is finished. He has done everything that needs to be done in order for us to have life now and beyond the grave. The robe is also a king's robe, like the one Jonathan wore. John is being reminded that Jesus, high priest, is king, enthroned above all authorities. Then John begins to describe the rest of the encounter. How do you describe something that is so overwhelming? By using the word we often hear today, like, some translations use the word as. His head and hair were white as wool, as white as snow. White like white wool, like snow. The words declare the agelessness of Jesus. He was there before the beginning. He will be there after the end. He is here in the middle. He has been around to see it all. The rise and fall of ancient Assyria and Babylon and Persia. The rise and fall of Greece and Rome. The rise and fall of the empires of Spain and Britain, of apartheid. Rulers have their day. Systems have their day, but Jesus keeps on standing. White as wool, white like snow, also speaks of the wisdom of Jesus. He knows what is really going on in any nation, in any city, in any church, in any person. He knows where it is all going. Nothing catches him off guard. And in the Western culture, white also speaks of purity, the sinlessness of Christ. He is altogether holy. And his eyes were aflame, like a flame of fire. Eyes give us away. They are the windows to the soul. John is declaring that Jesus purifies. Fire illuminates and penetrates, cleanses and burns away impurities. The eyes of the glorified Jesus not only look at us, they look through us and cleanse us. And his feet were like burnished bronze, refined as in a furnace. The reader steeped in the book of Daniel would get the point. In another vision given to Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon, all the human kingdoms of ancient history are represented as a huge statue whose feet are a mixture of clay and iron. A mixture which cannot bear the weight of those kingdoms. The glorified Son of Man has feet of burnished bronze, strong, firm, steady feet, already tested and strengthened by fire. All the other kingdoms rest on shaky feet. His kingdom rests on feet that endure forever. And his voice was like the sound of many waters. The word conveys awe-inspiring power and eloquence. The image also suggests that when he speaks, his voice, like the sound of water cascading over rocks, drowns out all other voices. And yet, like the sound of water over rocks, it fills the listener with peace. In his right hand, he held 7 stars. John is later told that the 7 stars represent the 7 angels or messengers of the 7 churches. But it might mean more. In John's day, they knew of 7 planets. Jesus holds 7 stars. People thought that life was under the control and sway of those planets. People then, as they still do today, consulted astrology tables, hoping to know what was happening and why. John sees the cosmic Jesus holding the stars. Jesus controls them. The stars do not control life. Jesus does. And out of his mouth came a 2-edged sword. The word John uses for sword does not refer to a long, narrow fencer's blade, but to a tongue-shaped sword used in close fighting. When you meet Jesus, the encounter is close up. Eugene Peterson puts it this way: Christ's words are not limp. They cut through willful resistance, divide good from evil, overcome rebellion, and establish righteousness. And his face was like the sun shining with full force. Can you feel John reaching for some way to convey the unconveyable? His face like the sun, blindingly bright, comfortably warm or unbearably hot. His face brilliant like the sun, shining on John. In the Hebrew Bible, it is a great blessing to have God's face shine upon you. And when I saw him, I fell at his feet, though dead. Yeah, no doubt. The same hand that holds the stars reaches out and touches John. The glorified Jesus does not remain aloof. He reaches out and touches John and us. Notice something about how John has arranged the verbal portrait of what he saw. The first thing and the seventh, the white head, forgiveness, and the shining face, blessing. They go together. 2 and 6, the eyes and the mouth, both organs of relationship. They go together. The third, the feet, and the fifth, the right hand, parts of the body that express capability, go together. All leading to the fourth observation, the voice. It is what Jesus says that finally makes the difference. But he placed his right hand on me, saying, "Do not be afraid. I am the first and the last and the living one. I was dead, and see, I am alive forever and ever, and I have the keys of death and Hades." Jesus says, "Stop being afraid. I am in control." John is being told that the disciples of Jesus need not fear the Neros or the Domitians of history. For even if they put you, a disciple of Jesus, into the prison of death, Jesus, the living one, comes with the keys and sets us free. Jesus has stolen the chief weapon evil uses to enforce its rule. Jesus has stolen the weapon of fear. Fear is a powerful force. Fear can keep us from doing what is right, and it can make us do what is wrong. All fear is firmly rooted in the fear of death, the fear of criticism, the fear of rejection, the fear of financial loss, the fear of pain, is all at rock bottom the fear of death. Let the imagery grab you. I have the keys of death. I am alive and I have the keys. It is while standing in the middle of the 7 lampstands that Jesus dictates messages to each of the 7 churches. The basic burden of each message is to enable the churches to overcome. Overcome the desire for wealth and pleasure. Do not be held captive by violence and the fear of death. Have a clear vision, a purged imagination, to see the present in light of the future. But more importantly, to see the present in light of the unseen realities of the present, the risen and living Jesus among us. Behind the thin veil, Jesus is with us, clothed in a robe reaching his feet, wearing a golden sash across his breast, his head and hair white as wool, white as snow, his eyes a flame of fire, feet like burnished bronze, with a voice like the sound of many waters, his face like the sun, shining on us and blessing us, saying, "Stop being afraid. Stop being afraid. I was dead, but look, I am alive forever, and I hold the keys of death. You need not fear anything that comes your way. I hold the keys." Amen and amen. And our next hymn is Voices United 602, Blessed Be the Tie That Binds. Allow for programs like these to help people continue to flourish. thank you for your generosity. With thanksgiving for God's gifts to us, let us offer ourselves and the fruits of our labor for God's work in the world. And there's the offering plate at the back. Thank you to those who are signed up for pre-authorized remission or give online. Overcome the babble of misunderstanding among nations, and let all people hear in their own language and recognize in their own culture your unifying message of love. For the planet Earth, our home, Almighty God, hear our prayer. By your Spirit, renew the earth, make us good stewards of its resources, and teach us to enjoy its abundance rightly. For those in need of healing, Almighty God, hear our prayer. Known to us, God, we pray. And please speak aloud those that are weighing heavy on your hearts.
Judy Malbeck and her family. Her husband just passed away.
Betty Welsh. Donna McCrae.
Was undergoing various treatments for the conditions her body's fault in. Send your healing spirit upon those who are sick in body or mind. Restore them to health and restore them to the joy of salvation. For our neighbors and members of our civic community, Almighty God, hear our prayer. Teach us to be good neighbors, to live in peace with one another, and in friendship share the joys and burdens of daily life. For our children, God Almighty, hear our prayer. Bless our children, protect them from danger, and help parents and caregivers nurture them so they may mature in wisdom and grow in grace. For our enemies, Almighty God, hear our prayer. Bless our enemies, and show us how we may do good to them for the sake of Jesus Christ. In your mercy, Almighty God, receive our prayers, and according to your wisdom, provide all that we need. Through Jesus Christ, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, we continue to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. And our closing hymn is Voices United 705, For All the Saints. from the dead, who sits at the right hand of God in glory, yet is coming, yet is among us, and who sends the Holy Spirit to empower us for service in his name. May the grace of God bless you with peace. May the love of God, of Christ, sustain you with joy, and may the power of the Holy Spirit fill you with courage this day and evermore. Amen. Thank you.